there. Welcome to The Bite Shot. I'm Joni Simon, commercial photographer, and today I'm joined by...
Ryan Simon.
Hey there, I'm Joni Simon, commercial food photographer. Welcome to The Bite Shot. And today we have the distinct honor of having Mr. Simon here with us. And today, the reason that you have been brought to this meeting, this is not an intervention, although maybe it looks like one, is to talk about how we store our images, all the images and the videos that I'm capturing, the storage solutions that we utilize, but also some different options. Because would you say, like, the storage solution we have today, simple or more advanced?
Definitely more advanced.
Okay. So we're gonna kind of ease into it depending on what's your experience level. Not everybody is as fortunate as I am to have a Ryan Simon, an IT guru, in their life. Let's go ahead and dig into the solutions.
Let's do it.
So I think one disclaimer, you are not a trained professional IT expert.
I guess not.
But I'd say you know more than the average bear.
Yeah, I love this stuff. I'm a certified nerd.
Okay, so good. Certified nerd, Dungeons and Dragons all the way. Let's just put all the cards on the table.
Oh, well, not all the cards, please.
So we're going to kind of go, we're going to ease into this. We're going to start out with the simple solutions for, because I got to think, this may be you, that you are not, you know, an IT guru, or you don't have an IT guru in your life, you don't have a computer nerd, but you need a good solution for storing your files. Because I know when I first started taking pictures, we can remember back, and I was not paying attention to what I was doing, and I didn't really ask you, because I'm terrible about asking for help. And all of a sudden, my computer was getting really slow, because I was storing everything on the local hard drive, on the hard drive on the computer, and that maxed out pretty quickly. So we had to jump into some solutions. Unfortunately, you were there, but so for folks who are in that situation, we need a place to put our files that's secure and big enough so we can save for a long time, but not so complicated as maybe what we're currently doing. What's like your simple, basic, if the word router makes you nervous, what should you do?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the simplest, most straightforward thing is just one of these kinds of little guys. You've seen them. You probably were already thinking this at home. But yeah, this can work. It's just a portable hard drive. You can get them for your Mac, for your PC. Sometimes they're branded one or the other, but quite honestly, you just reformat it and it'll work on your computer. And they can be plenty fast, you know, to be able to do those transfer speeds you want. If you've got Thunderbolt or USB 3.0, depending on, you know, whether you're Mac or PC, get one that is compatible with one of those two formats, and it should be quite fast.
Because that is one of the things when we start talking about speed and why that's important, is if you're running, for example, I run Capture One as a tethering software. I want a fast enough connection so that as I am capturing the images and it is saving those to the drive, that it's doing that quickly and that it's not jamming up and getting super slow.
So that's a good point. If you're going to be saving things to your internal hard drive that's already in the computer, then, you know, it should be pretty fast. But maybe you're pretty full there and you can't move those projects. Well, you're gonna capture to one of these, you can do that. But key would be speed.
And so what are we looking for in the speed department? What's gonna enable you to be speedy?
Making sure that your computer or the drive you get matches the top potential speed of your computer. Okay. If you've got a really old computer that's still on like USB 2.0, which is like an old version of USB, then getting a 3.0 drive won't help you. But if you've got a reasonably new computer that's got 3.0 or some other similar technology, Thunderbolt in the case of Mac, then you should be fine and you'll be top speed.
How will you know if you have USB 2 or 3?
You should be able to look in your computer's like system preferences to see what type of USB it has. The color of the USB port actually matters is one thing you can look at.
Okay, good. We'll be sure to include that in the blog post that will go along with this. So you can go check that out, link that below. We'll be sure to include the info on the USB. So something like one of these basic drives, this particular brand, I've had this one, this actual drive, because I use this when I'm shooting on location and I need a good hard drive situation. I think I've had this for 5 years without any issues. Are there other brands that you would recommend?
Well, you bring up something important if I can kind of take a little tangent.
Please
here.
Do.
Because if you're taking your hard drive on location places, one thing you might consider is making sure the hard drive you get is an SSD drive and not an HDD drive. SSD is kind of the newer technology and there's no moving parts inside. It's just blocks of memory, kind of like your RAM is in your computer. The old style HDD drives, well, they're cheaper, which is great, and they're available in much higher capacities for less money, but they are bigger and they are more sensitive. So if you're traveling with it, there is a very real chance you could lose data. So if you're gonna be traveling, look for that SSD.
On the topic of these guys and any sort of external hard drive that you get, it's still like a solution like this, you do wanna make sure you're running regular backups on that. Because this is hardware that can either leave the premises, get stolen, get lost, or I've seen when I worked in restaurant point of sale systems and all those systems were running on hard drives, this was like before the cloud and everything, that a hard drive would go down and you are SOL if you did not have a backup. So tell us about kind of what are options for backing this up so that you have that redundancy.
Absolutely. You could definitely back this up to another drive. You've got a small drive that you use all the time for your projects, and when you're done, move it to the big drive, you know, and maybe that's cool. You got your cool little SSD, you take it out, you shoot your videos, and then you bring it back to the studio, immediately back it all up to your big drive, you know, and you're good to go. Now, what if there's a fire in your studio?
Yeah, totally.
What if some creeper breaks in the middle of the night and steals all your stuff? You know? Well, all your stuff is gone. So no matter what else you do, you should get some kind of cloud storage backup. So of course, like there's the big names out there like Carbonite, Backblaze, iDrive or iDisk, I think it's iDrive. Look into all those and see what works for you. Most of them should all have the same features roughly, but that will get everything out of your physical space and into the cloud where it will live indefinitely. And I highly recommend that for any of the solutions that we're going to talk about.
Awesome. Some sort of backup, because the worst case scenario, what's the big fear? Is that we lose files, and that was just the saddest thing ever. So.
Absolutely. Oh my goodness.
Avoid that at all costs. So that is kind of your basic, you know, for somebody who is not tech savvy, something like this. And how big do these come? I mean, you can get like crazy amounts of terabytes at this point.
You can. In a single drive, you can get, you know,
I think this one's like 2 or 3 terabytes.
Yeah, this is probably 2 or 3, and your SSD drives will generally be smaller because they get very expensive as they get very big.
Okay.
But if you go with a regular HDD drive, yeah, you can get 12 terabytes, 16, you know, still for roughly reasonable prices.
Would that have blown your 1995 self's brain?
Oh my goodness, yeah. When I was like building computers out of like scraps and stuff, and you know, like, I just put in like 8 megs of RAM, you know? Like, it's gonna be so fast.
Man, if you could only think in terabytes back then, your brain would have been just mind blown. So now what happens if there's, you know, kind of more advanced solutions. Let's talk like moderate, middle of the road, taking a step up from your external hard drives. First of all, what's a compelling reason to do more than an external hard drive?
Okay, couple good reasons that I can think of immediately.
Yes.
The first is that there's more than one person in your shop and you're sharing files. You know, you're working on projects together. Do you wanna like hand this thing back and forth to each other?
No.
Not really. It's better to have that on a network where you can say, oh yeah, it's in the client file. Just go check it out and grab that and look at that for me, you know? Done and done. So one thing you can do, if you're really on a budget, you can still use these. And then check your router. Sorry if that makes you nervous, but we are in moderate solutions now.
I told Ryan, I was like, routers make me nervous.
Yeah. He's like, don't get nervous.
Okay.
Here for you. Check the back of your router. You may have a USB port on the back of it. You can plug this in to your router, and this will become a network storage device.
Fancy.
Pretty cool if you're on a budget and you really need that access, but you're not quite ready to step up to an advanced solution.
Okay.
I would highly recommend you check that out, and then you go into your router settings once this is plugged in, and usually it'll have some kind of like device share USB option, you know, and you enable it, and then you can literally go through your browser, type in the address, the unique address, and it'll take you right to the whole file system there.
Wow.
Drag and drop.
So you can access that remotely then too?
Yes. It depends on your router in that case.
Okay.
We'll get to more advanced solutions, which guarantee that. So that's what I would say for people looking to do something where they need to share, but not quite wanting to buy a whole unique setup for that.
You know, we're talking about, because I think about file sharing and things like that, why would maybe you not want to do instead like a Google Drive or a Dropbox, or like, why would you do this over something like that?
Well, you certainly could. Those do get expensive, of course, as your collection of things grows. You've got to pay Google or one of your outfits more money for that as it goes. Also, uploading to those devices can be slower sometimes. You really got to watch, because like the upload speeds of your local area for your cable network provider, what kind of internet you have, sometimes those can be much slower than your download speeds. So if you really need to get something to a client, well, it's going to take a little longer. But yeah. I think that's going to be a minor frustration.
Yeah, I think it depends. I mean, if you're doing serious video work, though, because like whenever I film my YouTube videos and I need to get the files over to our fabulous editor, Yosef, I upload it to Google, but it does, like, I dump it all in there and then I walk away for a couple hours and come back. And so if you were doing something or, you know, working with people locally or had kind of this setup, then you'd be able to upload faster. I wouldn't have leave it and then come back the next morning situation.
Right. Yeah. And what happens if you upload that video and then it's not quite right or it's the wrong one?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I've done that. Yeah. I've done that. I've been there. Right. Funny story.
So for moderate solutions, I do want to give an honorable mention to a product, which is the Western Digital MyCloud Home Edition. It's a device.
I feel like that needs to be trademarked and branded. Are we getting at, are they paying for
they're
this?
They're not paying for this. So, okay. I mean, you can call us. Western I'll take a check. But it gets into the moderate solutions because it will plug into your network or as a USB device, you can plug it in there too. And then it will give you dedicated network storage that you can drag and drop from. It has a limited number of like apps that run on the device itself. And that's going to be a big distinction in the next round of stuff that we talk about, the more advanced solutions. This has a little bit of that.
Okay.
The apps it runs, which allow it to do more things. So it's worth looking at, especially because the price on it is pretty good for what you get. You end up getting like an 8 terabyte solution that can also do what they call drive mirroring. So you got two drives in there and they're exact copies of each other. So if one dies, the other one has got everything you need right there. You just take out your old drive, you throw it away, put a new one in, boom, you haven't even missed a step. That's kind of a nice feature.
Is that what we refer to as RAID?
That is RAID, very
good. Look at me knowing terminology. Yes. The idea of the information's over here and then it runs over here and then it kind of keeps that loop going so that you've always got a backup.
Yeah.
Hello.
Is it me you're looking for?
I say, were you either going to go Adele or Lionel Richie?
Oh, Lionel Richie every time.
So we've covered the basic storage solutions, the external hard drives, and we moved into kind of more of a moderate plugging into our router, giving us some kind of more advanced access, file sharing abilities. But now we are going to move into our advanced solutions, what we're currently using here. And so just to kind of help understand again, what's the compelling reason why you might want to look at a solution like we're going to talk about, let me just make sure I've got the terminology correct. Network area storage.
Yeah, very good.
Did I get that right?
Yeah, very good.
I've got the terms today. So network area storage, which is different than what we talked about in the moderate, or is that kind of a network area storage light?
It is network area storage, and for a lot of home users, it would be fine.
Yeah.
People who want to store their movies on it and everything.
But moving up to now this advanced solution, what is moving us now into this category? What's somebody experiencing that they're going to need these more advanced solutions?
The first good reason is scalability. Here's what we got when we first started thinking about the future and about, oh my goodness, what are we gonna do with all these files we're generating? This is by Synology, which is a very popular company that works in this space. This is one of their entry level kind of almost home business solutions. So
what is this? This is a box?
This is, it's a little computer.
A little computer.
And it's actually inside, you can see it's got two hard drives right there.
Super cute.
Probably still got photos on them. And then it's actually got a motherboard in here and it is a computer.
Effectively a computer in a box.
Right. So I plug this into the network and then I go to its IP address through a web browser. So when I want to access it, once it's plugged into my network, I just type in its unique IP address in Chrome or whatever my browser is, and voila, up comes this desktop. And I've got a file system. I can access all the stuff that's on the drives. I can actually drag and drop from my desktop to my web browser Synology desktop and store files. It's got little applications that you can install and run that will do all manner of things. You can host your video, your music, your pictures, of course. Mm. You can set certain things for sharing. So if you want to send things to a client, you can say, hey, here's a shared folder, and you can even set access to it. Like, this is limited, you know, to 1 week of access.
I don't think we're even doing that right now. I've been using WeTransfer like a sucker.
Oh yeah, you could have been doing that on the thing all this time.
Perfect. So that's really helpful, especially too, I've got to think, for people who are doing large files, big volume, because, you know, for example, for me, I save all of the files ultimately to the Synology in terms of like that storage. But then in terms of delivering the images and that system, I'm doing that through Photo Shelter. But you're telling me we could also just do all of that strictly through the Synology.
You could.
Okay. Yeah. Don't tell Photo Shelter. I mean, I'm a big fan, but
but
that's good to know. That can really consolidate the different softwares and the different solutions that you're using in your business and to provide permissions and controls.
Right. And one important thing too is security. On a device like this, you can set it to automatically back up through any of those services we've described before, the iDrive and Amazon Glacier and some of these things.
Carbonite.
Yeah. And it'll back up from this machine automatically. So you're not bogging down your main rig, which you need for all those things you're editing, while this is backing up.
Because if you had, for example, if we go back to the first solution with the, you know, Lacey hard drive, external hard drive solution, and you were backing that up to, say, Carbonite, that would bog down your computer, so you wouldn't be able to keep on editing or doing whatever it is you're doing.
Right, it's gonna be using up valuable bandwidth.
Whereas this is a completely separate computer in essence, and so it can be running in the background, doing its own thing, and you can continue to work uninterrupted. That's really cool.
Yeah.
That's helpful. That makes a lot of sense then too, as to my experience day to day. Okay, so when you open that up, you had two hard drives in there. What's the purpose of having multiple drives?
Ah, great question. So with a unit like that, you can buy them in 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 drive configurations, which just are open slots for drives. One of the cool things is, if you're really concerned about making sure you never lose a picture, is you can set it up in what's called a mirrored configuration, where you put one drive in and a second drive, and the two are exact copies of each other.
Mm.
If one drive fails, the other one still got everything on it. You haven't missed a beat.
And that's an automatic process that is running.
You don't even have to think about it. You just take the old drive, you can send it off to be fixed or throw it away, you put a new drive in, and they'll re-mirror each other, and you're back and running.
Because hardware is hardware, and hardware fails, and that is just truth.
Yes, exactly.
Now, that being said, though, that is not a replacement for your cloud-based backup solutions, because if both hard drives fail, then you're SOL. So.
Absolutely, yeah. And things like catastrophic things can happen, a flood in your house or a fire or something like that.
Yeah, the paranoia of losing files is real.
Yes.
And so the levels of backup are super vital, super important.
And that being said, don't go cheap when you buy drives. If you buy a solution like that, you will probably have to buy the drives separately. Sometimes they'll sell them together, but you'll probably buy them separately. Get good quality hard drives. It's just not worth going cheap and having them fail.
So what is a mark of a quality hard drive other than the price point?
Right, yeah, and you can't always go by price. The two brands I trust the most are Western Digital and Seagate. Western Digital's had a little trouble recently.
I feel like this is Mr. Simon's new YouTube channel talking
about. This is, yeah, so I don't know.
But
Seagate, especially their Iron Wolf series of hard drives are excellent. They're made for this kind of thing. They'll go and go and go, and their warranty is exceptional too. If something happens to that drive, you send it back to Seagate, they'll take care of you.
Oh, that's very cool. Good to know. So that's something we want to be paying attention to when we're looking at the drives.
Yes.
Can you come on all my videos?
Sure.
Okay. So obviously I'm super fortunate to have you, you know, knowing what to buy and how to put it all together and to rig it. But would you say, you know, that if I had to figure these things out, could I do it? Do you think, like, somebody who is not a tech nerd in the computer space could figure these things out?
Absolutely, yeah. With a little bit of courage and some YouTube, you can figure it out. There are a lot of tutorial videos for people on how to set up your NAS, how to set up your Synology device. It's all there for you. You can do this.
Yeah, it's just, it may take a couple pots of coffee.
Some patience. And here's an important thing.
Yeah.
Keep whatever solution is working for you at the time together. while you assemble and figure out solution number two.
We didn't make that mistake, did we?
We got a little ahead of ourselves once, but it's okay. We didn't lose any.
Okay, I don't recall losing anything or being forever mad at you. So
might not have said anything right away.
Oh, the truth is coming out, y'all. Truth is coming out. So, but then there are a couple other bells and whistles that you have mentioned to me that are helpful to make sure you include as you're considering these storage device solutions. So let's talk. Yeah. I mean, this is like super glamorous topic, you know?
Right.
This whole series, it's been like, oh, business bank account and usage licenses. I'm like, this is the least glamorous videos that I've ever made on this channel. But here we are. Let's talk about surge protectors, shall we?
Surge protectors.
What is a surge protector? Why is it on this list that we want to talk about it?
Most of you at home can look around your room probably and see somewhere that power strip with the plugs in it. And you go, isn't that a surge protector? No, it's probably not. Unless you paid quite a few bucks for it, you know, 25 bucks or 30 bucks. It's probably not an actual surge protector. It's just an outlet multiplier, you know?
Oh.
If your house gets struck by lightning or there's some kind of surge, the electricity could damage your computer or any attached network storage devices that you have.
Ooh, important.
And that would be it for that device and anything on those hard drives. It's worth looking at a real surge protector. And if you're gonna go into Amazon and look for something with a joule rating. That's joule is an amount of energy. And so good surge protectors will have really good joule ratings.
What would be a good joule rating?
You'd be looking like 2,500 or somewhere in there that would protect you pretty good.
Okay. And we've got one of those here.
We do have one of those here. In fact, we've done one better too. And this is something that's kind of neat. You should look up if you're in a place where power sometimes goes out, is getting a universal power supply. And it's just a big battery that plugs into the wall. And then it's got a bunch of its own outlets on the back. You can plug in your computer, plug in your NAS, and it will keep all your devices powered whenever there's a power failure. So it'll give you, 10 minutes, depending on the size of the unit, to get everything turned off or shut down the unimportant things and leave the important things running.
Yeah.
And it will protect you from surges as well.
We actually heavily utilized it on a photo shoot once that there was an unfortunate timing of doing construction on this space and we had to have the power out, but I had a shoot scheduled the same day. And so we didn't have power in the house, but I was still able to shoot tethered and save the images. That was shenanigans, I don't recommend it. But the universal power supply, that whole setup enabled my computer to continue to run and the backups to run, even though the rest of the power of the house was down.
Yep.
But I feel like we have covered a lot of ground here. We've got a lot of different solutions, all equally wonderful in their own right. Just a matter of what you want to do, how much money you got to spend, how many IT gurus you've got in your life, or how much patience you have to learn new things. But thank you so much for hanging out with us here today. And thank you to Ryan for doing the research, making sure we're all up to date. And we'll be sure to link some information down below on Ryan's got his own page, The Byte Shot, but it's BYTE.
Very clever, huh?
He came up with that. He's very punny. This man's never met a pun he didn't like. So we will be sure to link all of the solutions and information that we shared here today down below. But thank you to you. Thank you to you. We'll be back soon, and you stay out of trouble. Bye.
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 See, you can do it too. Bye.
Bye. I do the fingers.
The fingers.
Bye.
Is that how did? Oh yeah, I guess it is a little weird
elbow,
how I do that.
Elbow, wrist, rich, touch, pulse, good night, kiss.
High five.
Good job.
Good job on you. You're such a pro. So profesh.
Oh, nuts.
Sibilance. From the top. Make it drop. He put a ring on it. Don't mess with your microphone. Look how cute you are.
Oh my gosh, you're so cute. Look at you, Daniel. I'm a nerd with a third grade education and love for all God's creatures. So I'd love to help you out.
The mothership that beams you up, Scotty.
Yeah.
You're like, this is awkward. This thing goes together.